Hi, everyone, and welcome to a very special panel of the Colaba Conversation here in Mumbai. In this panel, we're going to discuss a topic which is as relevant through and post the pandemic as it was before the pandemic struck, which is how can we make our cities more inclusive for women? Mumbai, as a cosmopolitan maximum city, has been known to be relatively safer and more work-friendly for women. And women have also, of course, successfully been able to tap into the large entrepreneurial spirit of the city. But today we will be discussing the new opportunities and challenges for women's movement and participation in a city, the importance of incorporating gender-sensitive planning of physical spaces, as well as social factors like awareness and capacity building. Also, of course, how we can use gender-sensitive planning to help mitigate the unequal impacts of future crises and essentially make the city safer and more accessible for its women. To discuss these issues, we have a power-packed panel that has lots and lots of insight to share today, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce them. Priyanka Chaturvedi, Member of Parliament at the Rajya Sabha, Yashomati Thakur, Minister of Women and Child Development in Maharashtra, Shaina NC, National Spokesperson of the Bharatiya Janata Party, and Abha Lamba, the renowned conservation architect. Thank you all for making the time out to join us for this important conversation today. I'd like to start this panel by inviting all of you remarkable women to give some opening comments on the topic of how inclusive are cities today and how much are we as women empowered enough to claim all the spaces in our city. Priyanka ji, if we could start with you.
Thank you so much, Aditi and ORF, as well as Colaba Conversations, for having a very important conversation on women feeling safer in cities, and how it is important to make inclusive cities for women to feel not just safe, but also empowered by giving them economic opportunities. Now, when we talk about Maharashtra, more in line with India, has a 48% women population. But what is happening in terms of labor force, just like across the nation, we have women participating lesser in the labor force, which is economic hindrance, I personally believe, and it is important to have conversations about creating spaces where women come forward and work. They could be part-time work, it could be full-time jobs, or they could be entrepreneurial in nature. There has been a drop in a city like Mumbai as far as female labor participation is concerned, and it has been a humongous drop, which we need to work towards. However, it is extremely heartening when you have governments which prioritize women's empowerment, which prioritize women's safety. For example, last year, a women gender budget, specific budget, was around 7,300 crores. And I'm hoping Yashomati ji will ensure that number only increases along with the action plan and how we have delivered. Now, as far as cities are concerned, Mumbai has a development plan which has come up, which has made women's spaces a priority, creating spaces for women, whether it's about women hostels, about making safe zones, creating entrepreneurial zones for women, is something that we have taken up, whether it is medical facilities, health facilities. So I also believe that local bodies, local governments need to have, as part of their development plan, women participation and women safety as a key, I would say, policy measure and policy incentive for every government to follow. So this is how it works, whether it is at the government level, whether it is at a city level. The more we empower local governments and we ensure the priority is given to women as well, we will have more safer places. For example, I'll quickly give you two examples. We are now living in a before COVID era and there's an after COVID era. During COVID, women were, I would say, at the brutal end of feeling disempowered. While the all policy challenges have been to make women feel more empowered, but unfortunately, COVID put a break to all that. Women were at the receiving end of, I would say, all the mental stress that was happening. They were, besides their own professional work, there was a lot of household work that they had to do. Then you also had women losing jobs because they are the first ones to be cut down as soon as there's any kind of job cuts that happen, as well as the domestic violence that saw an increase across the globe, I would say. However, the government was sensitive enough to introduce a mental helpline for women. So in case they feel any kind of stress, they can feel free to reach out by creating toll-free numbers. Then we also had the chief minister himself, along with our minister for women and child development, Yashomati ji, talk about domestic violence. and, you know, empower all these state committees to be able to reach out to women who are facing this violence, have police sensitized to this particular issue, have women self-help groups also come forward and help such women. So I think these are extremely important spaces that women need to conquer, as well as feel that they own these city spaces and be a part of it, be seen, be heard, and to own. So that is where the government is working towards, and it is heartening that it is a priority for the state.
Exactly. You spoke about the double burden women now face during the pandemic of both domestic work as well as professional work responsibilities, and the fact that most of the informal care workers are women who have lost jobs. So Yashomati ji, I would like to turn to you now as a sitting minister of women and child development. What are your comments on the topic today?
Yeah, thank you, everybody. And thank you for calling me for this wonderful topic of discussion, and I should thank even Priyanka, and she's like insisted I have to be here. The topic itself is absolutely a good one. It is not the kind of topic that would want the media these days want the TRP karne ke liye. This is a very sensitive topic, and all of us are about it. Our state of Maharashtra has been the state which is this last budget was the first budget where the gender budgeting has been given a lot of stress and importance. And apparently, during that very time, the pandemic was declared and the lockdown was declared, and things became very difficult. But women and children were the people who actually worked during the pandemic. Are there toilets on the roads on every 25 kilometers? Where are the participants? Where are the people, public transport areas? Do we have those facilities? No, we don't. Everybody keeps announcing a lot of policies that I said last time. And the policies, announcing policies, okay, fantastic, fine. But implementation of those policies is the most important aspect that we need to go across. And we need to go across beyond our party lines, beyond
our
government. Yes, and beyond our governmental lines to achieve this. We as women really need to lay a lot of stress on that. Now, what I said was this, that though we have announced gender budgeting, still implementation is a very, very big challenge. Participation of women in all aspects has to be seen to be increased. So for that, we need to have a proper implementation of this policy. For example, having toilets every 25 kilometers. Even with the nutrition, like if you see malnutrition, it is on a higher side, increased in the urban areas. So this is where we are insisting as a government that implementation of the dhoran of the policy is very important. Unless a woman is healthy, unless a woman is physically and mentally safe and fine, and unless she feels the security of being safe mentally and physically, participation of women, whichever kind, is not going to increase. As a government, we are coming up with different policies, like having MIDCs for women, then having, participation of women. As far as even Gram Vikas is concerned, as far as urban development is concerned, so this would lead to increase of participation of the women in every aspect of whatsoever. The respected Chief Minister has been invariably talking to us and taking our meetings and insisting on the implementation. But apparently, as a government less and as a woman more, what has to happen is still to happen, because the sensitivity of the male counterparts needs to be increased and has not increased through these years. So there is a lot of things that does come. It does not end with gender budgeting. In fact, it starts with gender budgeting. It does not end with a safety audit. In fact, it starts with safety audit. And whether it is Colaba or whether it is Mumbai or whether it is a small village, it accounts to the same thing. This is what I want to say. That is over to you, Aditi, again.
Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Lamba, I'd like to turn to you for your opening comments now, because as a conservation architect, which has quite a confluence with urban planning, how would you think that construction of gender-sensitive spaces would be conducive to women's movement and participation in cities? Ma'am, you're on mute.
Well, I would say that Mumbai, compared to any other city in India, definitely has a much more equal space for women. And women feel way more safe in Mumbai. And I can say that as a working woman in the city. But having said that, I think there's always scope for improvement. And we need to constantly strive to see that. One of those aspects, obviously, is the more representation of women in the workforce that you have, the safer the city is for working women. And in addition to that, you know, what are the accommodation is a huge issue for women, so working women's hostel. But I would also say two things that need to be part of just every building that, for example, like even when you look at your own housing society, you have a servant's toilet. How many of you have even walked into the women's staff toilet in our housing societies? And very often, part-time help, domestic workers just don't feel safe going into those spaces. Similarly, within offices, how many of us and how many organizations actually have creches? Because that really is something that's critical, given the fact that a large number of women have to drop out of the working space post, childbirth. And therefore, I think both corporates and companies and government, beyond a certain, whether you put a turnover margin or you keep the number of employees, it should be almost mandatory to have child support and creches, even if not within their own building for constraints, but at least a kind of an all citywide linkage of creches where working mothers feel comfortable bringing their children to work or to leave them when they're working. And I think that's something to do with the building a strong community. They say it takes a village to rear a child. So as a city, we need to, come together when it comes to education of young children whose mothers are working women. And beyond that, I would say, again, I would also reiterate Priyanka and Yashomati ji's point of view that we need to have more public toilets for women. We need to have more inclusive spaces. We need to have to see whether we can stagger, better transportation facilities. Like right now, the government has taken a very good step of having this time during the pandemic when women can use the train suburban train facilities. So I think as a city, we are all working towards giving women their share, their fair share of the city's assets and infrastructure. But it's something that we need to keep working at.
Absolutely. And maybe it should be a statutory condition for all companies to have these elements, regardless of turnover and, number of employees, lest it lead to prevention of females being employed. Absolutely. So maybe that's something we can look at. Shainaji, I'd like to turn to you now for your opening comments. There have been conversation about spaces and creches, etc. But what are your views on safe spaces, not just in cities, but also virtually, since you're in the virtual space a lot?
So I said, for starters, thank you, Priyanka, because as an entrepreneur, my career and existence is Colaba. So as a working woman, every breath of mine starts and ends at Colaba. So thank you to ORF, Aditi, Saili, and of course, Yashomati ji, who I have a lot of respect for, and Abha, who's a personal friend and working with me in a lot of projects in South Mumbai. I think that, you know, when it comes to women in the workspace, the first fundamental is that women need to support women. When I say that with a lot of humility, but at the same time with a lot of anger. Sometimes I have seen that with my own career space, which has been a lot in the night. We have a lot of programs which go run into 2 and 3 a.m. And we see that that sensitivity that needs to be there, leave government aside for a bit. It has to first be even colleague to colleague. And I've seen sometimes that women don't really support women the way they should. And that should not be the space. I'm digressing from your question because I've heard all the panelists and I have an opening comment to make. Now, when we talk about the Factories Act, I think the one point which is the most important, which where it says protection of dignity and honor, protection from any kind of sexual assault where you have all kinds of harassment, and we've seen multiple cases. And as fully responsible employers, we have to think of the safety, whether it's within a factory premise, an establishment, a restaurant, anything, and transit from work to their home space. That is when a woman is working at night. But even in the day, I think the points that Abha raised about pregnancy is so important. How many workspaces actually give you a creche for your child? I mean, virtually in a city like Mumbai, where real estate is so expensive, these are not priority issues. What Yashomati ji said about toilets, yes, that is so very important. And I want to welcome the initiative of ORF, the state government as well, because this is not a political issue. Women should be allowed to work 24 hours, and it is their prerogative if they choose to or not. And let me also say on record, even where people have misrepresented the Bharatiya Janata Party, saying, oh, we are against 24/7, you know, working policy, I would like to say that, you know, whether it's Bhopal or whether it's Gujarat, where if you take the case of the Safara market in Indore or the new market in Bhopal, there are so many women working at night as well. If you talk about Ahmedabad, there have been shopping festivals which have been part of vibrant Gujarat where women have been encouraged. So I think all in all, we're at least on the same page holistically that women should be allowed to work where they want to work, work in the capacity that they choose to, and the numbers should increase. But the logistics of it, where each government has to ensure 24/7, CCTV cameras, surveillance facilities to ensure that women are also safe in workspace, and that could be in day 24/7. So as I said, it could be in the day, it could be at night too. But my fundamental point is that when we talk about outsourcing in factories, or when we talk about why has the percentage of women in the workspace dropped sometimes, and post-pandemic, what is the driving force? I would only want to say, let's keep looking at the periodic labor force surveys, and that will give us a basic holistic idea as to how many women are employed in hotels, in restaurants, in factories, what is the scope of increasing that. And as Mumbai, as a global city, as the maximum city, one would only hope to see that that number is at par with the male counterpart.
Absolutely. And I think people sometimes forget that the urban female labor force participation rate is lower than the rural workforce.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Sadly true. Sadly true. And it should be quite the reverse. I mean, I feel so happy that, you know, when my the girls who work in my establishment late night after shows, they hop into a cab, which is driven by a woman. That's why I said women need to also support each other and understand what our problems are intrinsically. Toilets being the main one, because if you look at the amount of cases of women who suffer from all kinds of diseases only because of restraint on their gallbladder, and not being able to go to a toilet for 24 hours, it's a huge toll it takes on your health. So what is empowerment of women? It is when you're safe, when you're secure, when you're educated, and when you're financially empowered. But that has to have an infrastructure to support too.
Absolutely. And I think I'd like to pose my next question to all of you, because all of you are always in the public eye. And as you said, across party lines, issues of women's participation, mental burden is is huge and everyone cares about it so deeply. So as I said, during the pandemic, I mean, everyone has shifted to the virtual world. So the public eye is also in the virtual world. So safety and harassment has also kind of moved into the virtual world. So yes. How would you, and cities here play less of a role and have less importance and credence. So how would you feel women can feel safer in this setup, in this digital world?
I don't know whether you're aware of it or not, but most challenges during the pandemic did come on the net and the cyber crimes that were happening and the increase. We as government, we started this eSakhi program where we got connected with most of the colleges across the state and where we certified and trained our eSakhis so that they could go. We call them eSakhis. So that they could, you know, be there in every district. We even had a video released, and Priyanka ji got all the stalwarts and actors and actresses participate in that. And then later on, Priyanka ji, I don't know whether if you've seen that or not, we made a video which said, cut the chain, like everybody during Corona was talking about cutting the chain. So we got a video done which said, cut the chain of anger, right? Because I don't know, you all must have seen that movie called Thappad. And for everybody, like my son refused to talk to me after that because he was so sensitized that, yes, that sensitivity has to increase for whichever way we go. So unless and until this happens, what we desire will not happen. This is what I want to say. So cutting the chain of anger is one of the most important aspects towards woman upliftment, as much as nutrition and as much as physical care and as much as mental health. That is it.
Priyanka ji, what are your views on whether women have suffered or benefited during the pandemic in the shift to the virtual world?
No, like Yashomati ji was saying, that there has been an increased number of complaints as far as the virtual world is concerned, increased cases of threats that are coming to women, increased numbers of, I would say, methods to blackmail women. So those are things that are a reality that we as a society, which is very patriarchal in nature, will continue to face. We face this in a pre-COVID era. We continue to face it in a post-COVID era. What she's talking about is very relevant. What she's talking about is sensitizing the male. When she said her son didn't talk to her because he was just so driven by what the message of the movie was, we need to create content like this. I saw a very interesting series. I actually fear to talk about it on social media platforms, but yes, I do take time out to watch some important series. And I saw one which was talking about marital rape. Women throughout their lives are conditioned to not talk about violence, not talk about the physical harassment that they go through. They're asked to stay silent because zamana kya kahega. There's another initiative that we began with as a political organization that we began with when we spoke about making women more empowered, where we took women police officers to various areas, had an all-women program, sensitizing them to the laws that protect them and how legally they can get help and how the police would come forward and help these women in case they're facing this kind of domestic violence, they're facing any kind of threats, they're facing any kind of blackmail or any kind of abuse. So these are things when you make women also aware of their rights, give them the confidence to speak up, because there are internal barriers to, I say there are internal and there is external. Internal barriers to empowerment, women empowerment, is there less confidence in themselves, a mind which is conditioned to believe that they are destined to face a life like this. Then there is also about educational barriers that they have. Then the sense of insecurity, because which Shaina had touched upon about women not supporting women in political spaces. It is true of women in every space because the kind of the positions that they have of power are very few and far between. So every woman holds on to that position and is less bound to help another woman to create more spaces. What we need to work towards is not to just hold on to your space, but create more space because you happen to be in that position of power. So let's create more spaces for women. And there is enough and more space that women can take even in political world, corporate world. women in the corporate world don't move from middle management to senior management, very few in numbers. Same thing happens in political spaces and across political parties. So every political party needs to nurture their women. And as far as digital issues are concerned, trolling is part of every woman's life. Every time I speak up on a particular issue, I'm told, how much do you know of it? Look at this dimwit, look at this bimbo, look at this, you know, pastry item, look at this item girl, look at this woman who, you know, can get, you know, all kinds of nonsense. So, and I think that's true for even Yashomati ji, it's true for Shaina ji, it's true across political parties. What needs to be done is to create an ecosystem that when one woman faces the harassment, irrespective of our politics, we stand up for that woman. And what we need to do is have a collective voice. Only when you have a collective voice can you have positive outcomes. When you speak above your politics, when you speak for your gender, when you speak about empowerment, you are not just, you know, contributing to a society, you're creating to a society which is more empowered as a whole, not in creating more exclusionary spaces and invisibilizing a gender.
Shaina ji, I know you must have so much to say about this. I would love to hear your thoughts.
No, it's such a pleasure to agree with everything that everyone said. And I ditto, Priyanka. I mean, I can't agree more. So there's no point in my repeating some of the points that Priyanka or Yashomati ji or Abha have raised. So we're all on the same page, and it's so nice not to just be arguing for the heck of arguing. I think the cause of women is way above any political party and any ideology or any believing that, oh, this is your proposal, so I need to oppose it, or it's my proposal, so you need to oppose it. Forget all of that. But I think for sustainable development and for cities and communities to be sympathetic, and I don't want to use sympathetic in a complacent tone. When we talk about, you know, Sadhguru once told me very nicely that it's not about women wanting compassion and being told that, oh, we are doing this for you. We are talented. We have to have that opportunity to showcase in the space of work, in the space of politics, in the space of anything that where a woman is involved. So I think if we have this gender-related infrastructure where we are able to say that, yes, if it is a woman working in the day, she needs a creche, if it's rental housing, if it's hostel schemes, if it's toilets, these are the things that we actually need. What else do we need? We need safety, equality, and that equality needs to be given by men being sensitized. And I say it many a times in my own party forum, that it's not just about beti bachao, beti padhao, it's about bete ko sikhao, bete ko samjhao. And that, are we doing?
Yeah, very true.
Are we even talking about that? How important is it for a man to understand that a woman is at par? If she has her work and her priorities, then it is the same for others too. And whether this is maximum city or any city or rural India, the point is we are a patriarchal society. We are male. We have this male misogynistic I don't even want to say, make it a woman versus man debate, because it's not about being male chauvinistic, but it's about understanding that to be gender friendly in cities where you want to make it beneficial for all stakeholders and all humanity, then we must all be supporting each other. So thank you, ORF.
Yeah, I don't know whether if I can take a minute out of this, whether did you all see the government's saying on this was that we celebrated the Savitribai Phule's Jayanti, and we said Savitri gharo ghari ani Jyotibacha shodh jari. So it was a wonderful concept where we said that every house has a Savitribai, where education and women's upliftment is looking forward. But not every house necessarily does not have a Jyotiba. So that was, yeah. And that applies to everything. It applies even on the cyber space. So
something I'd like to also add, Aditi.
Absolutely, please go ahead.
It is very important when we talk about a patriarchal society, like what Yashomati was saying and what Shaina was saying. It is very important to have men who understand situations like this. They also come forward and help in the, and which is happening. I was amazed when Aditya Thackeray ji took the oath, where he invoked his mother's name as well. That little initiative, where you also bring in your mother's name, goes a long way in showing dignity and respect to the woman who shaped you. And that I think leads to some positive changes. When you put up signals, you know, traffic signals, which showed women, you are taking a step towards making this city inclusive. These are very small steps, but these were covered across the globe simply because it connects to the societies that we live in, that a simple acknowledgement, a simple thing like, you know, acknowledging your mother is something that goes a long way in bringing women into the public discourse and discussion. So he for she is extremely important to reach the levels that we are hoping to reach. External barriers, I spoke about the internal barriers. The external barriers such as sexism, misogyny, and you know the biases that you see will only come to an end when we come together as a society. I think the Jyotiba Phule context was very important because it was him who empowered as a husband. He not just empowered and gave light to her dreams, but he allowed her to go all the way to bring a change of mindset for women as a whole and a society in Maharashtra, which feels extremely empowered. And what we are today are the fruits of burdens that they bore when they were struggling to create spaces for women. And I think we need to acknowledge those sacrifices too and acknowledge their contribution to almost every day in our life.
Right. You spoke of he for she, and I do have another question. Everyone was talking very correctly about gender-sensitive infrastructure that is conducive to women's labor force participation, like creches and even lighting for safety. A lot of these decisions need to be through gender-responsive decision-making, which means more women in high positions in administration, in politics, in legislation. Are quotas the answer, or is there another
Absolutely.
Yeah, to increase? Shainaji, you can...
I want to speak on that.
Go ahead. How can we increase gender-responsive decision-making for these decisions to be made? Because we need women at the helm to create such spaces and such policy decisions.
I am completely for 33% reservation, and I've said it on multiple forums. Fortunately, Priyanka is in Parliament and Yashomati Ji is in the legislature. So I hope that they will espouse this cause, because genuinely, forget this tokenism. Ek ticket diya, ek mauka diya, wo nahi jeet sakti hai, wo kya kaam kar sakti hai, unko to itna mila hai, unko to ye hona chahiye. Please, let's move beyond. Only if you're given that initial opportunity can we showcase our talent. And forget showcasing our talent, there'll be thousands and crores of women who are just waiting for that opportunity to showcase how capable they are. And intrinsically, and I mean it with absolute humility, we are all definitely much more conscientious than the male counterpart on a lighter note. So in that sense, the opportunity is only awaiting. And I hope that in the days to come, we have a 33% reservation parliament going all the way down and vice versa. And this is not just about people giving lame arguments. Lekin unke pati to chalate hain. Let that be. That could be the initial phase. Eventually, you will have a lot of competent women in India who go beyond just being party presidents or being the speaker or just being a chief minister. This is just a handful. Right now, we're at a dismal 9 and 11% respectively in parliament and assemblies. So I think we need to move way, way beyond.
Yashomati ji, your views on this?
I do agree to what Shaina ji said, but for more participation, I think sensitization, as we said earlier, is absolutely important. To teach a woman has to be taught to your son also. That is also very important. And beyond that, I feel that not only 33%, it has to be more than that, but not necessarily it should come from a reservation policy only. It should come proactively. And for that, it starts from the house and it ends, it does not end at all. So it for it to start, cultural sensitivity, gender sensitivity, and that has to start from your home, in your school, in your college, where you are working. It's everywhere. Making Nirbhaya guidelines is not the end to it. It has to go beyond. So it has to be imbibed in everybody's heart and your soul, and implementation of policies, of course. Only then it will happen. Otherwise, it's a big stories.
Yeah. Priyankaji, what about you? I mean, in order to create inclusive spaces, of course, leadership at the top has to increase in order to for policy to disseminate. So how would we be able to manage that?
See, I have said this enough number of times that when the constitution was being framed and we had women participants in the constitution, when the constitution was coming about in the Constituent Assembly. However, when the discussion on quota came for women, it was mutually decided with women in, talking about not needing a quota system at that point in time, because we were giving equal rights to women. Unlike other nations, much developed nations than us, women had to struggle for even those equal opportunity rights to vote. However, India was moving on a progressive note in the belief that the future generations would bear the fruit of their hard labor. Unfortunately, as time moved, we became more and more patriarchal. So there are two ways about to go about it. A, we have to introduce a quota system, because it is a well-established fact that in whichever nation a quota system was established, there was more women participation. So the minor excuses like, oh, the husband is running the show on the name of his wife, etc., we can cast that aside. We have empowered many women through panchayat, etc. When Sri Rajiv Gandhi ji brought about this change, we've empowered thousands of women across panchayat who are now in positions, leadership positions. And we can cast aside some percentage, which of course has men dominating, using their women's name, wife's name to be able to run the show. Now, in terms of other policy changes, I feel when I see, Naveen Patnaik ji, part of a regional party, chief minister of Odisha, introduces a quota system within his party for ticket allocation. When Mamata Banerjee, a woman leader, chief minister of West Bengal, introduces a quota system for women within her party, that's when you see a parliament which moves from 12% to 14%, because you have introduced that system within your party. It gives me great hope when my chief minister, when my party leader and our environment minister talks about grooming women leaders within the party to be able to take on a role in the assembly levels and the national levels. And we are grooming towards that, working towards that. We have projects that are in pipeline. So that is when the change happens. There is a quota, of course, which protects you, but and ensures that you have a foot in the door. And there are political parties which are sensitive and which also understand that it is time that you stop invisibilizing women and having them in positions of power and on tables of power where they can be equally representative of what they want to see their state going towards, working towards, and their nation moving towards.
I think that is a good note to end the panel on. And I, for one, feel very confident and empowered listening to all of you agree on so many topics that are close to so many people's hearts, and gives me confidence that women can, in fact, support women. And together, as a collective voice, we can really see the change that we want to. So thank you all again.
Thank you.
Thank you.